Dear students, good morning. Welcome to Law Excellence. Let us start the discussion on today's newspaper, that is 10th March 2017. The first article, Stability in the Time of Change. Here, we are going to see how the world is changing and how we have to bring in new institutions to manage this change. And voting with our feet, we will be looking about the changes in the voting behavior in recent elections in India. Open gates, it is about immigration in the case of West, immigration in European Union. What is the recent judgment of the European Court of Justice in this matter? How it is going to impact the immigration policies of the countries there? Making a clean break. This article specifically talks about the convicted people, can they be used to promote the government policies? Are public spaces, why they are by and large filled with the political figures? This is what is the question it poses for. Now, the first article, Stability in the Time of Change. Now, here let us understand the change first. Next, we shift towards how the stability has to be achieved. This change happening has to be seen from two dimensions. One is a spatial dimension. The next one is temporal dimension. Now, if you see the temporal dimension, the change is happening only today. As stated by the Western theorists, the change is happening in such a way that we are moving towards illiberalism. It is not true. The change is happening from long back, but today it is happening in the heart of Europe and the United States of America. Now, if you talk about West Asia, the change, the jihad, all these have started long back. And if you go to Eastern Europe, the breakdown of USSR has brought in the change. The 2008 economic crisis has brought in the change all over the world. So, change happening today itself is a myth. And second is the spatial dimension of the change. So, as it has been stated that the liberal order is facing an enormous challenge, we need to understand that the liberal order is not part of the entire world from the beginning. The liberal order, or the preachers of the liberal order, are majorly from Western Europe and the United States of America. This is where a new change has occurred. There is a movement towards populism, nationalism, far right that is happening in France, Germany, UK, United States. That's why we are able to face this crisis of the liberal order today. And further to this, there is another aspect of the change, that is shift of geopolitics from Europe and Atlantic Ocean to Indian and Pacific Ocean and to Asia. If you take the PricewaterhouseCoopers statement, by 2014, India, that is E7, they are called emerging seven economies, their GDP will double the G7, the existing top global economies. So it means there is a shift that is happening from West towards the East. And the second is, what has prompted this particular change, growth of illiberal order in the West? I can say two things. One is communication revolution. The second is globalization. Both of them are connected with each other. Because of the globalization, the identities have come under threat. And the immigration, open immigration, and free movement of the capital, it has led to growth of global elites. The financial capital has moved across the world many a times rather than the trade happening across the countries. So due to the financial capital gaining the significance in globalization, the global elites have gained, but the common people across the country, they have much in loss. So in this case, the globalization has come under question, and the right wing is started playing on the insecurities of the people in this globalized era. So that is one reason why the liberal order is coming in challenge. Though this article did not deal with, I want to state that the liberal order also have this intellectual arrogance. This is also a reason for their decline. Now, further to this, another aspect of this is the communication challenge. Now, today we are in the world of alternative facts or post-truth era. So it means that we are not dependent on evidence-based decision-making. More and more we are shifting towards the half-truth. There are manipulative politics and the minds of the voters is getting changed. So it means there is a change, there is uncertainty in the world, but this has become more visible because it has hit the very womb where the liberal order is born and is being sustained. So in this context, how the foreign policy has to change over here? In this case, the stability need to be achieved, either arms race stability or deterrent stability or through crisis stability. Now, arms race stability is almost appears impossible today, as conventional weapons have become as deadly as the nuclear weapons, and almost all the countries are free to produce the conventional weapons. Now, the two other stabilities that are being left are deterrent stability, crisis stability. So now the language used by most of the countries is of deterrence stability. Now, if you take the Korean Peninsula for that matter, the North Korea testing the missiles, it has provided a justification in deterrent stability for the US, and finally it has brought in the third missiles over there, terminal high altitude missiles over there. It was resented by China, and China will take some deterrence action against this. So this deterrence is maintaining the stability in the world order. And the second is crisis stability. Now, if you take the Cuban missile crisis, how it is averted, you can understand this crisis stability. So here my point of view is a better communication between the countries and mutual understanding of proper understanding of risk reduction mechanisms are essential for crisis stability. So my point is, if deterrent stability is depending on the vulnerabilities, missile defense technologies, the crisis stability, it depends upon proper information sharing, communication links, risk reduction practices between the countries. So this is how stability has to come up. The biggest challenge the world is facing today is the multilateral institutions which are created for the erstwhile era are unable to manage this particular change, unable to institutionalize the stability. That is what is the biggest challenge of this world. This is the article of Mr. Rakesh Sood. Now coming with the voting with our feet. Now, voter turnout in our elections has increased. And in the West, the voter turnout is decreasing, and this voter apathy, voter fatigue, especially with regard to young generation, was a concern over there. Unlike this, as election and election passes on, India is celebrating its elections and its democracy. And second important aspect is, the voting choices have decreased to the people. That's what is the famous argument. So the people who have supported NOTA and who are recommending to extend it as a right to rejection. So these all make an argument this, the choices to the voters need to be increased. But if we observe the number of votes polled to the NOTA, the concept appears to be overextended. And most of the cases NOTA is used where the constituencies are reserved, it shows that we are still unable to accept reservations in elections in India. And another thing is, the gender gap in the elections is reducing, and women are gaining their own agency, their own decision making in the elections. Previously, women used to take the voting pattern based on decided by the men of the family. Now, women are making their independent decisions, and they have become themselves a separate group or to be considered by the political parties now. And another thing, if we observe parliament, assembly and local elections, as we move close to the local elections, voter turnout is increasing. So the people where the personal choices are affected, they are providing or they are expressing their views through voting. So the personally felt outcomes are pulling the voters to the polling booths. Finally, where the party competition has increased, there the voter turnout is high. So it means that the voting behavior is changing towards better in India. And if we see the previous articles, the identity politics are receding and more developmental politics have entered, and the development is determining the voting behavior of the people. The next is open gates. The European Court of Justice has given a ruling today. So what it says is, The member states of the European Union, they have the right either to grant or deny asylum to the people coming to the shores of Europe. Now, European Union's Charter of Rights, Charter of Human Rights, this is a lighting guideline for the entire world. So Europe has become or has granted the liberal asylum till date. So this judgment, it has given the voice to the right wing, which is opposing the open immigration or asylum for the people who are coming from West Asia. So that's why it is seen as a retrogressive step. And coming to making a clean break. Understand, this article is written in the context of Tamil Nadu. So here, Jayalalitha was convicted in the disproportionate assets case. Can the public funds be used to promote her name? The Section 8 of the Representation of People's Act clearly states that any person convicted is disqualified to contest the elections, participate in electoral activities for a period of conviction plus 6 years. Then, how can their name can be used to mobilize the votes? How can the public funds be spent in glorifying their names is the question. But the fundamental question is, why India is obsessed with the political leaders? Why India has to name the public spaces with the political leaders? Why can't the alternative role models be developed in India as the confidence of the people in the political leadership is decreasing? That is, what is the question political? And who is behind the Kerala killings? I'm not going to discuss this article. It is highly politically motivated. Now, let's get into the fisherman issue, the right to fish. Now, after the LTTE war has over, the things have dramatically changed with regard to the fishing in Sri Lankan waters. As Tamil boats have entered into Sri Lankan waters, it was opposed by the Sri Lankan Navy. Now, LTTE, it has indeed supporter of this fishing. Now, Sri Lanka has banned this bottom trawling. And most of the Tamil fishermen, they resort to this bottom trawling. And Sri Lankan Navy is sharing this information with Indian counterparts. And India is not taking any proper action. And it is becoming an issue whenever a fisherman is killed. It is the time the country shall find a proper solution to this issue rather than ad hoc measures. Now, the next article, what does the age mean under the POSCO Act? Prevention of sexual offences against children. So, in this act, the age of the child is defined as less than 18 years. So, it depends upon the biological age of the child. Now, what about the mental age of the child is the question. Now, a case has come up where a cerebral palsy patient has a mental age of 80 years but biological age of 40 years. So, if you consider the mental age, the victim shall get the justice from POSCO Act. But however, as the law do not consider the mental age, she was tried in the normal circumstances through normal law. So, in this case, as the objective is to protect the full right to the children, so the POSCO Act need to be amended in India to define the age as both biological age and mental age. That is what is the recommendation of the article. Coming to the news page, leaders must tell voters not to take bribes. In this, there are three fundamental issues which are discussed. So the bribing of the voter shall be a cognizable offence. And second, if there is bribing as expected by the Election Commission, our Election Commission observers recommends for cancelling of the elections as it involves bribing of the voters. As of now, Election Commission has no provisions to do that. Election Commission is persuading that with the government. And then with regard to simultaneous elections, it was a huge logistical exercise. And in relation to the state funding of elections, Chief Election Commissioner talks that it cannot be a standalone exercise. It shall be a part of a transparency move in the entire election funding in India. So a standalone exercise of state funding of elections is not a solution to the electoral corruption which is existing in the country. So these are the opinions expressed by him, which you can use to update your Representation of People's Act notes. So these are the articles for today. And I have given you the notes at the end. The notes will be posted at laics.in/civilsprep. And Sandeep sir has uploaded his second economic survey, second video on economic survey. Please go through that. So today or tomorrow, I will upload these case studies related to the self-help group movement in India and across the world. So we can go with that. All these videos are there, will be posted soon on laics.in/civilsprep. Or you can also go to the YouTube channel of CivilsPrep or Law Excellence. You can go to the YouTube channel over there and type the CivilsPrep and you will get the answer. You will get that particular channel and you can see the videos over there. Thank you very much and all the best.